JKD and MMA have some similarities and obviously some differences. So we'll start with the similarities, right? First of all, Jeet Kune Do was established from 1967 to 73. MMA came on the scene in 1995 when Royce Gracie showed everybody the value of gunfighting. Now, in MMA and in JKD, we share a few common things. We're both striking and grappling, and we have to mix the two. So, like, for instance, if Teddy's here with me, I have to learn how to get in on his legs and start running him on a double. Let's go left lead, let's say. Bang, just lowering my level, getting in on double legs. You'll see drills like that in MMA. You obviously see them in Jeet Kune Do as well. Now, we also have submissions, ground fighting, very similar to MMA. But when you look at what JKD is, it's kind of closer to what MMA was back in the day. What was MMA called, Teddy?
No holds barred.
No weight classes, no rules, no time limits. So with modern, high quality JKD, like the way it's taught here in New York Martial Arts Academy, you're learning how to box, you're learning how to kickbox, you're learning how to wrestle. But for instance, you have to employ the foul tactics because in a street fight, there is no rules. So simple example, if I have a tie clinch and he postures up, I might elbow him, I might skip knee, whatever it is. But in a real fight, I'm gonna put my thumb in his eye. I'm gonna headbutt him. If he's got hair, I'm gonna pull it and I'm gonna punch. I'm gonna use every bit of the rules against an MMA fighter because any rules that they're using is protecting them from things that'll hurt them really badly. Like a kick to the groin, like a side kick to the knee. And on that note, John Jones, the greatest of all time, uses a very interesting Jeet Kune Do tactic, a side kick to the knee and an oblique stomp to the knee on his opponents, and we'll demonstrate that. Teddy, first show please an oblique stomp. If we're in the same lead, he'll oblique stomp my lead kneecap. Just like, shot. Now, if we're in opposite lead, he'll probably use his side kick to my lead kneecap. Very classic Jeet Kune Do self-defense move. Same thing here. There it is. There it is, don't worry about it. And there it is. So again, you see John Jones, arguably and most likely the GOAT, using that oblique stomp, side kick to the knee to destroy his opponents. He broke up many opponents with this tactic, but if you listen to Rampage Jackson talk about it, he's still hurt from it. And he put, I forgot the fighter's name, another light heavyweight in the hospital by slamming both of his kneecaps out with that shot. Another funny John Jones tactic. He finger jabs people in the eye, which clearly works. So another tactic, right? Let's say I'm fighting a little bit square. I'm ready to block the low kick, but I'm not ready for a pendulum front kick to the groin. So for instance, in MMA, you are not allowed to attack the groin. But if I was standing square in the street, there it is. And that's when the pendulum is perfect. If I'm standing square, that pendulum front kick to my groin works really well. Okay, well, what else is a little different? Well, when you do Jeet Kune Do, you actually lead with your dominant side. So you start with your right hand forward and your right foot forward as a righty. Same thing when you're wrestling. You have your wrestling stance, you have your right foot forward because it's easier to wrestle with your dominant hand forward. If I put a knife in your hand, it would be easier to go with the knife with the dominant hand, dominant foot forward. In boxing and Muay Thai, kickboxing, they stand, obviously, left hand, left foot forward. What's the idea? All my power is in the back hand and the back leg. Well, they're also wearing a big glove. I could break your nose with a jab, I could break your nose with a left hook, your chin, whatever it is. So now from this position, I can easily lower my level and grab you for my double leg. If I'm standing in a pure Muay Thai stance, there's a reason you don't see the Muay Thai stance in MMA as much. From this position, he can lower his level and double me, right? But when I'm locked and loaded, I'm a lot easier to just grab my underhooks on the way in. So even the JKD stance is built for totality. It's built for striking. It's built to lower your level down to shoot. It's built for movement. And I think it's just an overall better stance than most fighting stances for fighting that includes both striking and grappling. Another similarity between MMA and JKD, right? The low kick. Low kick destroys people, whether it's a street fight or an MMA. Now, you'll see MMA fighters and Jeet Kune Do practitioners firing less body kicks because if he throws that right kick to my body, I can catch it and now he can get swept. In Muay Thai, you get swept, you get back up. you get swept in MMA, you end up on bottom. You get swept in the street, you end up on bottom. So it's more effective for him to attack my thigh, or even better now, on the calf, right? So calf kicks, low kicks, very common in MMA, very common in Jeet Kune Do, because again, the body kick has a little bit more risk. It can get caught, you can get thrown on the floor. Now, let's kind of switch to differences again. And I'll just talk more about schools than style. There's four elements of MMA. You have boxing, wrestling, Muay Thai, and Jiu-Jitsu. If you look at most MMA academies, they focus more on Muay Thai and Jiu-Jitsu. Here in New York Martial Arts Academy, we do a lot of boxing, a lot of wrestling. We do the kickboxing, the clinch as well, and the ground fighting. So I would say we have a little bit more totality than most places. Again, I can't talk about other places. I can only talk about what we do. But I have noticed that a lot of MMA places are basically doing Muay Thai and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. The boxing and the wrestling is missing just a little bit. And to say that you're doing MMA without having boxing and wrestling is kind of false, because it's the most important element of MMA. The most important element of MMA is wrestling. If you look at the champions in MMA, most of them come from a wrestling background, and then they end up working their striking. Less and less practitioners are choosing to fight off of their back, because you can get ground and pounded. Most people obviously in MMA want to be on top. Same thing like Jeet Kune Do. I don't want to be on the bottom, even though I did Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu for many years. So just dial it back. What do most places here in New York teach? Muay Thai and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. What's missing in their curriculum? Boxing and wrestling. That's another thing that I think that we have here in New York Martial Arts Academy. It's a little different than most places. A lot more boxing, a lot more wrestling in the curriculum. Weapon guys, now there's more elements. So if you are only used to hand-to-hand, you could be Mr. MMA all you want. But let me tell you something. When a knife comes out and you don't know how to deal with it, you can get in whatever MMA stance you want. You're gonna start getting cut. You could shoot on me. You could do whatever you want to do. If you understand how to use this thing, it is the greatest equalizer. If you are a smaller, weaker person, but you understand how to use the blade, speed and accuracy with this thing kills all. And another thing, in Jeet Kune Do, even though we teach our students how to ground fight, we tell them to avoid the ground outside because of multiple attackers. Imagine he's mounted on somebody. Imagine this imaginary, but he's mounted, and I'm that dude on bottom's friend. I could kick him in the face. I can hit him in the back. I can run behind him, put my own RNC in. So basically the threat of multiple attackers and the threat of weapon does make it a little bit crazier in the street. But dial back. What do you need as a good Jeet Kune Do person that you would also need as a good MMA fighter? The highest level skill. And that's what makes our Jeet Kune Do different here at New York Martial Arts Academy. We teach our students how to actually box, how to actually kickbox, how to actually wrestle, how to do submissions and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu on the floor. But we keep that foul tactic. We keep that MMA flair. We keep that knowledge, knowing that I might fight somebody bigger, faster, stronger, and I may have to do something that's unconventional so that I can get home and see my family. Thank you so much.